happy Thursday. Guys, it is 1 week to Halloween, and we are so excited here at the Skits Comic Studio. That's right, our studio. We are so happy. I even got my shirt on. It's. That's right. Ooh, I know you may be scared of clowns, but don't worry. This brown clown will make sure that you have no frown. That's right. That is right. We are doing it big. I am wearing my pimp shirt of awesomeness, of slasherness, of chopness, of anything that is stalker-ish because of it. Love you, Stephen King out there. Love all of his books. I used to work with the promo team, the promotional team, marketing team with Warner Brothers for this movie. Little fun fact, they did a knee bolt house in the middle of Hollywood and Vine, and I was your girl that oversaw it all. So it's all good in the hood. So shout out to my LA peeps out there who remembers the knee bolt house right there in Hollywood and Vine. We also did Player One as well, which was a fantastic movie. Love it so much. It played my favorite boys, Depeche Mode, which will be getting their honor where honor is due. They're going to be inducted into the Hall Music Hall of Fame on November the 7th, I believe. It's like an HBO special, but go and check it out. If you are a devotee, if you are a Depeche Mode fan, they are receiving their Hall of Fame, their Music Hall of Fame induction on November 7th. As you know, the pandemic basically shut everything down. And let me just tell you, I tried to get some tickets, and I'm actually happy I didn't go because those tickets were not cheap, okay? But it would have been fun. It would have been a once-in-a-lifetime chance to see my favorite band. Let me you see your favorite band be inducted into the Music Hall of Fame out there in Ohio, and just let us know. Guys, we have a great and special guest with us today. Real quick, we're going to be doing some fun things today. We're going to be doing some giveaways. We're going to be giving away and doing some giveaways. That is right. We're going to be doing some giveaways. I also have my bags of candy just for you. We are going to share these bags of candy with our special guest that is going to be with us today. This is the Kitty Mix, the remix, the Kitty Mix. So if you guys, if your Halloween is canceled, I am so sorry, Nominees Patre, for you, because it is a sacred holiday for those who love candy, those who love horror, okay? So what I will do for you, I will eat this candy live on TV for you so you can feel, you can hear, you can see the candy-liciousness that you're missing out on. And I really do am praying for you because Halloween should never be canceled. I've told everyone already before, go down to your local CVS, your Walmart, dress up. You already got your mask on. Easy peasy. Scream it out. That's right. Wear your scream mask or whatever mask you choose. Go down the aisle, start shopping, putting it in your bag, and then, you know, you out. Yes, you must pay for them. Yes, but still, you out. There goes your Halloween. Halloween is saved for the children. Anyway, guys, we have a great and special guest. Killer Killadelphia, Killer Killadelphia. I know you guys know that theme song. I've been doing Killer Killadelphia, Killer Killadelphia for so very long. I am literally in a sea of Killer Killadelphia, Killer Killadelphia. But before we bring out our special guest, I've got my special guest, you know, my main man, Skits Comic is here with me today. Michael Siegenthaler, our creator, illustrator, Skits, for Skits the Sum, book one. He is here. Ooh, he's actually live in the studio. What up, Skits? What up, Michael?
Hey, I can't believe here I am. I'm actually on show with you.
You are here. So if you guys don't know, we are a husband and wife team. We have our book out there on Indiegogo, Skits the Sum, book one, three books, three varying covers, and what else?
Three various stories, one insane adventure, all wrapped, signed and numbered in a bundle, specially for you. Go get it. Go check it out. Go buy it. Indiegogo right now in demand.
That is right. And guys, just FYI, real quick, We've got to give away our first giveaway right now. That is right, our first giveaway for the first three people who have not purchased their three-book journey or would like to get their three-book journey over there at Indiegogo. Go ahead, do the dang on thing. Go ahead and go to Indiegogo, Skits Comic. The link is right there in the description as well as that. The first three people to buy a three-book journey will get, boom, we'll get this Scooby-Tober Inktober drawing that Michael graciously did for us live on air. Go ahead and do a little do-do-do-do-do-do. We will send that to you, and that is the first giveaway for the day. So make sure that you are buying the three-book journey. You have until 10 p.m. tonight, East Coast time. So if you own this replay, it's 10 p.m. East Coast time for the next three people who purchase Skits the Sum Book 1 on Indiegogo. We will pick from those random three people starting now, and we will send that drawing straight to you. So without further ado, what we got and what we're gonna do for you, we're gonna do it. Are you ready? I see him in the backstage. He's like, nah, I ain't ready, but we're gonna have Jason Sean Alexander to the show. What up, yo?
Hi. How's it going?
That is good. He's like, what?
I know, man. It's like really hard because, you know, we bring the energy. We're just trying to kill it out there, do the best we can, just like Philadelphia, you know, bring as many people in and just wow people. So it's like we got to bring that energy and be excited because here at Skits Comic, if we ain't excited about our book, no one else will be. So we're just out there and pimping it and being as excited as possible.
I feel like
Especially the Sham Wow guy.
Jason Sean Alexander. You sound like the Sham Wow guy. Like, right now, what we got for Jason Sean Alexander for $99.99. So, wow. Hey, Jason.
Hi.
And good afternoon to you, sir.
Afternoon.
Thank you for being on this illustrious Come Get Some show. And the reason behind the Come Get Some is why? Because everybody needs to come get some. And this is live. That is right. Everyone wants to see it live. So we're coming to get it live. That's right. How you doing out there?
I'm doing great. How are you?
We're doing very, very well. It is hot out here.
Yeah, it's like 80 degrees here. Yeah. What's the big deal? You know, we're like in the middle of the country. It shouldn't be 80 degrees right now, but we'll take it. We love it.
We will take it. Are you a hot person?
And you got the humidity.
Yes.
Yeah, not to bore everybody talking about weather, but Tennessee and the humidity, like I couldn't get out fast enough.
We're from Florida. Humidity in Florida? Yeah. Come on now.
Yeah, that was a leg up moving to get Tennessee, yeah. Yeah.
That sweat drop is like this. But see, that's how the blackness keeps the clean. You know what I'm saying? All that heat, all that sweat, you know.
Keep it shiny.
I mean, the fountain of youth right there in that sweat. I'm just trying to tell you, it's right there in the sweat. So I was telling you backstage before, I was like, I can't deal with this cold. When it starts to snow, I'm not about that life. I'm just not. I live in New York, and they called me Kenny from South Park because I had a little, my jacket, I was all puffed up, and all you saw were the slits in my eyes, and they were like, come on, Kenny. And I was like, I can't deal with this. New York, I love you. But not about this life.
No, that is a brutal cold. That is New York. No.
Yeah, no, thank you.
Yeah.
No, thank
you. And then it got worse for me when I went to Chicago during the winter time. It was like the middle of January. And I was like, oh, I am definitely not about this life for no barbecue on the south side. I don't think so.
Chicago, I've never been to in the winter. I don't think so, but that scares me. So I'm good.
I was trying to get the famous barbecue on the south side, and I was like, I am not about this. I'm so sorry. South side of Chicago, y'all can keep that. Y'all can keep that. It is too cold. Anyway, we brought Jason Sean Alexander on the show today, everyone, to do a little horror. I just remastered my top 10 remastered horror list, and let's see if Jason can't comply with this list. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man.
You know what I'm saying?
Do it, do it.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, at first, why don't we ask Jason, like, what is your favorite type of horror? What inspires you as a horror artist to do what you do?
Suspense, mostly. You know, I like jump scares, things like that, but I like anything that just keeps you there, you know, and I think that's what I think that's what horror really benefits from, because every shot is kind of, you know, really should be like directed to evoke some kind of emotional feeling, like some kind of claustrophobia and that kind of a thing. So like, even visually, like, the suspense, even when I'm like drawing panels, like I'll reference horror movies just because, like, you know, they're framing their shot to get some kind of a thing. So I, you know, anything that's just going to keep me there, like, almost, it doesn't have to be the payoff of the scare. If I'm just, I realize after the movie, I'm exhausted. I was tense the whole time. Like, that's a winner. But that said, like, you know, it runs the gamut. I like psychological horror. I wanted to do like makeup and visual effects before I got into comics. And so anything gore, you know, proper gore, especially back in the day, you know, gets me going. So I like, you know, I like all kinds of horror. I just mostly like horror.
And I am the horror of the family, the horror person. I'm watching it.
I wouldn't say you're the horror of the family.
I am the horrible.
It's a hard one to.
Horrible. Come on now. Let's keep it clean. Let's keep it clean for the kiddies at the time. The horror of the family. I told Jason, you're going to have nothing but fun here at Skits Comic. I'll come get some. You're going to have fun and you're going to laugh. I'm literally, like, when I take my shower, I'm listening to Tales from the Crypt. Yep, I literally am both the cartoon and the HBO old school. Then I'll jump to Tales from the Dark Side. Then I'll jump to
the vampire thing you always listen to.
It's called Dracula, the 90s Dracula, where it was all pimped out and good. It was all good. And then I watch some other stuff like Vampire High. I'll watch that. It's like a high school, like in Canada somewhere. It was all vampires. I'm like, ooh, I love vampire Canadians. I love it so much.
Yeah, I like the horror movies that had to do with haunted houses. That's my thing, you know, like the Legend of Hell House, that sort of thing from 1973. I love that sort of stuff.
So I was going to ask, okay, so is it the Haunting of Hill House? Which one is where they're sleeping in their place for the night?
That's the Haunting of Hill House.
Yeah, Haunting of Hill House.
Hill House. He's talking about Hill House.
Yeah, the legend the original, of Hill House.
The original black and white of the Haunting of Hill House is
that's good.
Wow. Like, you can watch it today because it's all like sounds. It's all imagination.
Yep.
It's hearing something on the other side of the door, and you can't not be scared by that.
And they didn't really need to do much. They really didn't. It was just a creak of hair. It was the look of the eyes that the camera panned that shot in, you know, into that close-up. And it was like, ooh, what you seeing, girl?
Back then, they just had to do everything suspense. It was like, what's out the corner of your eye? You know, it's perfect, perfect stuff.
It is.
I mean, that's why I like Psycho. Psycho is like my favorite. I mean, it is like, I've seen it, I don't know how many times, but every time I'm just like, genius, genius, genius. Exactly. You know, you don't have to show everything.
Exactly. Now, go right ahead. Go right ahead.
What? No, I got nothing. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. You're like, I got nothing. Psycho, yes. We went over some of our genres of horror, as well as the decades of horror. To be honest, this is my visual list of what and how horror was placed for everyone, even growing up, or if you were like maybe taking a film history class or whatever. Really, I mean, you had the top-notch horror that was anywhere between the 60s and the 80s. 60s, 70s horror was like the satanic witchcraft horror. Everything during those decades, that's all they were doing. It was all about Satanism. It was all about witchcraft. And they didn't know where else to go. It was all like, oh, should we do Daughters of Satan with Tom Selleck? Or should we do, you know, The Spell with, you know,
That's also when Ouija boards became really popular.
Ouija boards became very popular. Yep, yep. You had Helen Hunt as a child was doing in the spell. I was showing you that. You were like, is that Twister? Is that the Twister girl? I said, that is the Twister girl. Helen Hunt started off in a witchcraft movie. That's right.
Night of the Living Dead.
Night of the Living. Yes. Okay, see, when I say there's genre horrors, I didn't get this was zombie. This was the satanic witchcraft horror era.
This was the 60s then it became and
70s. A zombie horror. I mean, it was like zombie everything. It was like, you know, of course, our George Romero, of course, those classics, George A, excuse me, put that A dot in there, Romero, classic.
Rest in peace.
Yes. Fun fact, when he was casting that role, fun fact, oh my gosh, it was the best thing, especially for Black America, because they actually got to see someone of note, someone that was leading the way for a film. And I remember I basically said this in my first review of Killadelphia. I said, this is giving me Night of the Living Dead vibes, because I see that this man here is the lead. He don't know what's going on, but he got a shovel and his gun, and he's going to come get you, and he's going to defend himself, and he's going to live. You know what I mean? So
That man is iconic in that movie.
Yes.
And I think Tony Todd nailed it in the 1990 remake. Romero, you know, casting the lead and all of that, being a Black guy, he was purely... Oh, there's construction happening in the building.
Okay. He was purely knocking at your door. I heard a sudden rapping at your door.
Of all the time to have, yeah, just mysterious knocking. But he was just casting for the best actor. You know, and it just so happened to be this guy, you know, and it was everything about that movie still works. It's all, you know, even though you have this huge, you know, broad span of field, you know, all this freedom, we're still stuck in this one little house. You know, there's no real place to go. And it's, you know, perfect. Like, you know, more horror films should focus more on that. Just the human drama, the human anticipation. Like, you know, you're stuck in one house. Like, that's pretty inexpensive. It just some good writing in there, you know.
Like, it is, and yeah, the exactly. Budget was easy. You didn't have to like do shots, you know, over in distant seas, you know, lands or anything. It was just a nice little wooden house. I mean, you had the graveyard scene, but that can be shot anywhere. But you had a nice little graveyard scene. I'm coming to get you, Barbara, which is the famous line. And then you just had him in the house trying to find out, like you would in any other zombie horror movie, which is the trope of, okay, you're in a house. Who are you going to have on your zombie kill team? You know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, okay, I got a girl over here crying. She out. I got somebody in the back, you know, downstairs. Oh, he out because he's too bougie. And then I got these like other couple. You know, there always is that trope of who is going to be on your zombie kill team. Who is on your zombie kill team?
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Arnold Schwarzenegger. Okay. Yes.
Even though he's not really in too many horror films, but that would be my number one pick.
Okay. All right.
80s Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Okay.
not today's.
Oh, so we can just pick anyone for this kill.
Anyone. Random. Yes. Anyone. It can be Data from Star Trek. You know, whatever. The Data would be efficient for you. He's like, I believe it'd be 2.5 miles to the next George border.
Bronson.
Walking Dead.
I take Charles Bronson.
Well, you don't want to have a kill team of elite, you know. Like
I mean, if you're going to have a team, you need to have like the best of the best, you know.
My first person is MacGyver. Thank you. MacGyver is on my zombie kill team. Boom. Top that.
Okay. This wins.
Who's on your top three, Jason? Who's your top three
to
on
protect
your zombie
me
kill team? Yes,
from zombies.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, anyone would probably do a better job than I would. Throw a rock, and I'm probably hit that guy. I just don't think I'd be that great in a situation.
Oh no! Well,
I could take people down. I have a problem. If I'm in a situation like that, everyone's gone.
So as of right now, the kids team, I would have them. as part of my kill team.
Yeah. Who's on his kill team? Skits team.
The Skits team!
We're supposed to be like, yay! That's what I said. I was like, face.
Yes, I am classically trained in the art of kicking butt. Yes, yes, I am. So I am on that team. Thank you, Jason, for that. And also, we were going through, and of course, you have Rosemary's Baby. That's epic in itself. That in itself is a masterpiece in suspense to me because you didn't know what was going on. You had all these like, oh, respect your elders, all these old people trying to help out, you know, you're in this thing. And to the very last ending, that was that twist. And that was a perfect way of masterclass of figuring out, well, what's going on? She's using this tennis roof. She's doing all this. She's getting little herbs. Why is my husband all of a sudden blowing up? You know, like he's like a superstar. What deal did he make? He made a deal with the devil, and that's what he did. So shout out to you, 60s and 70s horror. Moving on, we have our, of course, we have our really our 80s slasher films. Okay. And you know, everyone knows a slasher film. Slasher films are like the number one thing that people can think of all over the world is someone that will slash their way you. What is your number one slasher film, Jason? Shall we not have dead air time? Let me go over this list.
Not like an actual like huge. It has to be favorite slasher would be Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Okay.
Boom.
Okay. Perfect. Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Just the
sheer brutality of it.
He's a scary dude. He has a mask, just like all the other guys from that time period. However, his mask was made of human flesh.
That's right. I'm coming to get you.
The original still scares the hell out of me. The original, yes. I am still totally frightened from the whole drag down the hallway and the shutting of that door. And every time I'm like, God damn, because when they hit the sled, everything was so tactile. Everything, you felt it. And it was brutal. But that was at the time later when I got into special effects. That's when I fell in love with like the Nightmare on Elm Streets and the Friday the 13th and the more serialized. You know, Leatherface always seemed like the almost like the grown-up version, like because they all kind of got cool, like they, you know. But Leatherface was always gross, like you know they're gonna sell you. Everybody else could have clever lines, something, but Leatherface was like, oh yeah, me and my inbred family, let's make toys.
That was the gore factor, and that's one of the things about slasher films is that there was the heavy gore factor, or was the heavy factor of like that blood, it always like splattered everywhere. So whenever you turned around, you saw like a splatter on the wall or a splatter on the refrigerator or whatever, or it was dripping from the knife. And that's what made slasher films so iconic, because you knew those tropes. You knew when the blood was dripping that, oh, they just finished off somebody, or you knew when there was somebody falling in the woods. It's like, oh, you gone, girl, bye. You know, it was just like...
See, that's what I really liked about Texas Chainsaw Massacre. The most annoying guy went first, the dude who was in the wheelchair. I mean, you felt bad that he was in the wheelchair, but once he started talking, you didn't feel
the brother,
bad for him.
Yeah.
It was time for him to go, and he went.
That was a running man's game.
That was. That cardio, that Zombieland, that whole list. Cardio, if you don't got it.
When you're watching that girl running at the end, like, she's doing laps around that property. She comes back and she's, I'm back in the house. And I'm like, God damn, she's going again. And she goes right back up.
It's like, where are you going? Run away.
If there's one unrealistic moment, it's the fact that Leatherface like kept up with her. I'm like,
he was a little big and he was hauling around the chainsaw and everything. Yeah,
which is so funny because every 80s slasher baddie, they never run. They always just walk. And that's the most iconic trope as well. It's like, why are you running and they not? They just like, I'll see you in like 2 minutes.
It's the beauty. It's the beauty of the boogeyman. You know, it's like, no matter what, you're never getting away from this guy. You know, it's whether it's Jason, whether it's Michael, whether it's Freddy, it's no matter what, they don't have to do anything. And that's what scares you even more, because no matter how far you run, you can still turn that fucking corner.
That is true. On our list, we have Nightmare on Elm Street, Friday the 13th, The Evil Dead, Halloween, of course, Halloween. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Reanimator, Hellraiser, of all things, Evil Dead 2, because it's just good, the whole trilogy, Child's Play, and Pumpkinhead. Anything coming at me from y'all's perspective that can get my ankles? No, thank you. Well, no, ma'am. No, ma'am.
You missed out on one, a good one here. Probably my favorite horror film from the 80s is Chud. Cannibalistic humanoid underdwellers.
There you go.
Underdwellers. There we go. Yes.
There you go.
I mean, yes, I do love Chud. I was like, wait a second. Like, you put my brain straight back onto horror, like, from the 80s. Like, I even started making lists. I have Salem's Lot, Alien. The Howling.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, The Howling is just the best.
And my absolute, well, my favorite movie of all time, it gets put in the horror category, is Jacob's Ladder.
Oh, yeah.
And that is my all-time favorite flick, but it falls into the horror. But for me, it literally has everything. Like, it's suspense, it's scary, and then at the end, I cry every time. And so,
Now moving on to the 80s zombies, like I was saying, we got them broken down to genre. Of course, we had Night of the Living Dead. That was just beginning up until then, the Dawn of the Dead, Creepshow, love Creepshow, Day of the Dead is like, mwah, just the creme de la creme, Return of the Living Dead, Night of the Comet, Night of the Creeps, and then Creepshow 2. Look at you like, yes, Creeps, yes. Those are your zombie classics. And guys, it just let you know, if you have not seen any of those that I just told you about, you need to go see them. It's on Amazon Prime right now, or Tubi TV, or Netflix. Yes. You need to find a way to jack it off the internet, because that way you're able to download it and see it. I'm serious.
Especially Night of the Comet.
That's
just such a favorite from when I was
younger. I love that film so much. We're moving on to our vampire films. Of course, we're still in the 80s, guys, so keep up. We have Fright Night. Once Bitten, that is my guilty pleasure. I love Once Bitten. I will watch Once Bitten, Jim Carrey, any day, anytime. I don't care. Love Once Bitten.
Nice.
Yes. Lost Boys, Fright Night? Of course.
Huh? Yes, Lost. Was Fright Night 80s or was that 90?
1985.
Oh, 85. Yeah. 85. What am I doing? Yes. Nice.
Like, what am I doing?
They remade it recently. Didn't
we're going to get to the remix. We're going to get to the remix.
So I'm like, maybe he's thinking of the remake.
Yeah. Colin Farrell, we'll get to you, Colin. My best friend is a vampire. You had Vamp, of course. You know, you had the Lost Boys, of course, which is the iconic Lost Boys. Fun fact, I was in 24 with Kiefer Sutherland, so my dream has been realized. Yes. And so I'm very excited about that. And of course, you have David Bowie as a vampire. You can't get any better than Bela Lugosi's dead in the opening scene of that movie. I just cannot. It's awesome. Jason's grinning. He's like, that's a good one.
Yeah, I think we're good.
So he just agreed with you.
Yeah. And then we went down to the dumps of the 90s. 90s, I'm sorry to say, but the 90s had very few and far between. Yes, we had Candyman. Yes, Tony Todd, you are God for the candy. In 1992 for Candyman. Then it went to Evil Dead, you know, Army of Darkness, campy, fun, love it, you know. Nincompoop. Bram Stoker's Dracula. Everybody was trying to be on that one. Then you had, you know, even Anthony Hopkins came out to play, you know, for that role. He was like, I'll give you some car money, some car notes. It's all good. It's all good. I'm Anthony Hopkins. It's all good. Interview with the Vampire, Scream, and then Night of the Living Dead, the remake of that. Those were basically all your 90s, and that was not it. It was nothing else. It was not like an explosion of horror, and that was it. I'm sorry. Fight me. Fight me, Jason. Fight me.
Was that 90s?
Oh, no.
I like, again, it's a good list.
Interview with the Vampire was fantastic.
Oh, I love.
That's probably the best one. If you talk about serious.
Tom Cruise, I love it. It had comedy.
I like the remake, Night of the Living Dead.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like my full list for the zombie movies are Night of the Living Dead. You can watch both the original and the remake, and you're fine because I think they're both absolutely stunning. Mm-hmm. Dawn of the Dead. Watch the remake.
Mm-hmm. You like I actually like the original Dawn of the Dead.
I like Dawn of the Dead.
It'd be fun, but I think that remake took the essence of it, and it killed it. I thought it was incredible.
Really?
I love the remake of Dawn of the Dead. And then Day of the Dead, the original.
Okay. Like,
I think I think there's another Day of the Dead out there, but that original down in the bunker with Bub just can't be beat.
They just can't.
The remake was done, I think, by the same people did Dawn of the Dead. It was shortly thereafter. They did them about the same time that Dawn of the Dead, Day of the Dead.
It was a dead cast.
It was
a dead cast. And we're going to take a little small little break here. And you know why? Because it's time to do another giveaway. Guys, the next three people to buy Kiss the Sun Book 1, we are going to be giving away free comic books. That's right. We are going to send you some comics of our choice to you. So the next three people, we will go ahead and, yes, Night Flyer. Thank you, Leg Kick, for Stephen King's Night Flyer. We are going to be giving away some comics to you. That is your treat. No tricks, guys. No tricks. We're going to be sending you some great comics to you for the next three people. And this time, you have 24 hours to purchase Kiss the Sun Book 1. The first three people, they only have until 10 p.m. tonight. You'll get this drawing by Michael Siegenthaler. It is the Headless Horseman. He did it live from Scooby-Doo, Scooby-Tober. Yep. You're going to get this in the mail. We were picked at three, from the three at random.
Right.
And then the next three people, we're going to be sending you comic books. Because why? We're all about comics here on this show. That's right. Comics, movies, horror.
Yep.
What else is there? Oh, food. We talk about tacos.
I talk about food. That's my favorite thing to talk about.
A lot of tacos goes into this. Collard greens.
Fried chicken.
It's all good. It's all good. It's all good. So that is that contest. Now, Jason, what I want to do, I want to go over my top 10.
It's a giveaway.
It's a giveaway.
It's a giveaway.
Well, yes.
You don't have to do nothing but buy Skits of Some Book, the three book journey.
That is true. The three book journey. That is true. So, Jason, what we're going to do right now, we are going to play our top 10 master list. And I want you to give me a nod, yes or no. You can dig it. You think this should be on the list, okay?
Sure.
Right here on your screen. All right, here. Let's get it going. Sound is down because we don't want to get that strike. So, guys, at number 10 on my top 10 list, I got The Cabin in the Woods. Jason, what do you feel about The Cabin in the Woods?
That was incredibly fun.
Okay.
Can we risk spoilers? Do we care about, like, can I talk about
it? We don't care about spoilers.
Yeah, we don't care.
We just give it. Go for it.
I love everything about this movie because I didn't expect any of it. And then still at the very end, my old manness came out. And I'm like, wait a second. These two little burnout shitheads get to decide if the rest of us get to live? And they're like, Boogie, we're done. Maybe they should start over. And so I'm like, what? And then they do. And then humanity dies. And so I felt the end of our fates being left up to those two was upsetting.
But remember now, when you're in the pool, it's not just a zombie family. It's zombie torture horror family. She was like, I had zombies too. And he's like, yes, you did. But it's zombie torture family for you. So that is an awesome one. Now, for number 9, I think this was a pleasant surprise as well. Here we go. Number 9 is You're Next. What do you think about this movie?
Here's my really vague recollection.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken, the person that becomes the badass is the person that you don't expect to be the badass.
She's the final girl. Yes.
I loved it. I thought it was a really fun movie. I thought that one was great. It was a lot of good tension.
Yes, this movie was the twist of twists. It was like honorable mention along with Saw. Saw was on my other top 10 list because the plot twist and the fact, here we go again, you're all in one house. You don't have to go anywhere. You don't have to do anything. You're all in one house. So I thought this movie did a phenomenal job coming out of the gate here by showing you what tension looks like. So yes. Number nine.
Oh, just a quick digression. I think another great tension one is Strangers.
Yes. Ooh, look at you, Jason.
Freaked me out.
Yeah, that was a good one.
Look at you. You're not. You see, now your juices are flowing. Your juices are flowing. Let's look at what number eight is on my list. VHS. Fight me. This is the best cyber horror that's out there. If you have not seen VHS, it is the best, seriously, deranged found footage anthology horror category that we love.
It's better than Blair Witch.
It's better than Blair Witch. It had Blair Witch all rolled up in one. Have you seen VHS, Jason?
I have not.
Ooh. I haven't either, so there you go. I mean, she brought this one out of left field somewhere. I was like, VHS, what's this?
Yeah. VHS is a collection of these guys, real quick, they go into a house, they're stealing these VHS tapes, and on these tapes, they're starting to like watch them, and what, unbeknownst to them, that's going on in these tapes, but someone is filming them watching those tapes, basically putting them on VHS. You see where I'm going here?
Nice.
You see where I'm going with that? Nice. But VHS, a great anthology type of horror for the ages. I mean, it is good. And the fact of the matter that it had all those jump scares that you were talking about, all of those things, it was just right up your alley. It was perfect. Yes, so go check out VHS Underground, low-key horror, but it's one of the best, and I want you to fight me on it. Fight me.
I haven't seen
the new scary stories to tell in the dark, the Amazon one or whatever that they did the film of, not the documentary.
Yes,
another good anthology. I was really surprised.
Yes,
I jumped quite a bit, and then there was a couple of character designs I was just jealous of. I thought there's some really good creepy goodness in there.
So maybe some borrowing and juxtaposing.
Outright thievery.
That's what you're going to get. Let's check out my number seven. Can you guess what this is?
I haven't seen this original one.
What? Jason, what?
I haven't seen the original.
This is Ju-on. The American version is called The Grudge. I love Michelle Geller. I love her ever since Buffy the Vampire. Yes, I'm a Buffy the Vampire Slayer. She did a fantastic job in this movie. But Ju-on is my number seven. And this is what you call the revenge spirit horror.
Yeah.
It's like, it is one of the most talked about films during that time. Because when people actually saw the original, they were like, ooh, look at scary little boy going down on a thing. Creepy little hand coming up on the shower while you're taking a shower.
A little creepy things where it's like, whoa.
It was just creepy.
It's like, how do you think of all those things, you know, bringing them into one film, you know, little creep factor things. Well, it's like they deliberately did that, like, thinking about creepy things.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's nice. What is this? Is it Korean or is it?
No, it's Japanese. Yep.
A zombie thing earlier, the last train, the train to Busan.
Yes. Epic. Yes.
Yes, that. We just revisited that and it's incredible.
That was fantastic.
Some
of the scenes in it where they're going through the train just fighting and everything, it kind of reminded me of that one scene from Old Boy, you know, where he's going down the hall and you get that side scroll. It had that type of stuff to it where it was just like, oh, this is great.
J-horror and K-horror, I think, are some of the best. And guys, just double check my list from the last time I gave you a top 10 list of Japanese, Korean, and Thai horror that's just out of this world. I mean, it literally puts us to shame. We're trying to be like, oh, look at our special effects. Oh, look at the gore. It's like, no, there's like, nope, we do it better. And they do. Like the eye, the original The Eye, not the Jessica Alba, like sort of, no, thank you. That right. one scared me a lot because you start going, oh, there's something in my eye. You know, like you start looking right. around, you're like, whoa, whoa, whoa.
I think the last one that really scared me was Audition.
Oh. Oh, did I just scare Jason?
It's so, that's not cool. That's not cool.
That is what she does. She goes, Audition yeah. is on my list. Yes, it's on my top 10 Japanese, Korean, and Thai list, like basically Eastern films, horror films list. And the fact that she is just like, oh, look at me. And everyone's like, yeah, okay, where's this going? And then at the end, she just brings it. I just yeah. love it. So
it was a different movie until that bag in the corner moved. And from yes. that point forward, it was just a slow descent. And I was like, oh my God.
Yes. Yes.
I was curled
yes.
up in the theater. I was just like,
were you like this? Happening? Were you like this?
Oh, it was just painful. Like everything was just like, I'm hanging out with, actually, I saw it with in North Carolina with Kent.
Did you?
We watched it together, and I'm just sitting there, and just like we're both like, God, all of the, yeah.
No. And just FYI, everybody, Kit Williams has a special cover for Kiss the Sun Book One.
That's
if
right.
we
want to
name drop.
Fantastic cover by Kit Williams. We were floored yeah. to actually have him work on the. On the first book, I mean, it was like a dream come true for me personally because he's
yes.
just one of my big influences.
How we got Kent is Michael gave me his top five list, and he's like,
I gave you a top 10.
Well, top 10.
I didn't think we'd get
number
10.
But then we cut it down to size, and I literally contacted everyone, and everyone said yes. And then I said, there you go. Here you go, baby. You ask and you show. I got you. I got you.
Yeah. Yes. There you
The things you do for love. Let's go ahead and continue on, everybody. If you do not know, number six, 30 Days of Night. I'm sorry. This is a vampire movie after my own heart. Why? Because they just kill. They're not here to have sexy times. They're not here to make other, you know, empires of vampires. They're not here to sparkle. They are here to kill because it is 30 Days of Night. The storyline just. It's just vicious. The storyline is cold. Yes, they're in Barrow, Alaska, so it's cold. The faces of these vampires, I mean, phenomenal when you look at them. They're not pretty, they're not sparkly, and they're not just in it to win it with my cool, you know, black jacket and look at me, I'm, you know, wearing the best fashions. No, this is a vampire story for me. Is this gonna be similar to Killadelphia TV.
These guys are true death dealers. You know what I'm saying?
They are true death dealers.
Who is the dude in the cell? Ben Foster?
Yes.
Yeah. He was brilliant. Yeah. Like he in every scene, not just visually, but that in accent, like every scene he was in was uncomfortable. Like he nailed yes. it. He was a scene yeah. stealer every time. They're like, we got to kill him quick because otherwise we can't, you know.
Yeah,
but exactly. yeah, the design, I love this old world. You're getting this other accent and this, you know, it is mm-hmm. kind of like, you know, why haven't we done this before?
Yeah.
But it was, it's a really, really, really fun movie. I don't ever rewatch it to be like really into it. I typically watch it because I like, it has nothing I really disagree with. So I love okay. having it on in the background while I'm working and stuff because I'm like,
yes.
this is yep. just fucking cool. Like it's all like the compositions, the cinematography, the D on this thing is insane. Like
yes.
in those colors, like what I did with like all the blues and the reds contrasting.
Yes,
like,
yes, that cold steel. Yeah. I wanted to make sure that it was good yeah. for you. Awesome.
And you're right. Those guys were brutal. They were sending them out there like bait. It was fantastic.
He's like, we're not here to make an empire. He goes, cut off their heads. We don't want to turn them.
Yeah.
Every other vampire, you're like, oh, we're turning. We gotta build up. Yes. So like, no, thank you.
Yeah, everyone's like,
we're eating. That's it.
Everyone dies. No one lives.
And period. The best line he said was, we should have done this years ago. And I was like, Exactly.
And they needed it. They needed that line. Because it was like.
They needed that line. But that is a vampire movie after my own heart. And it was just, like you said, it was just brutal. Just brutal. And then you just, again, you had a town, but they were holed up in a house, you know? And it was like, you can't say too much.
Anytime you gotta Niles with that storyline. What a great concept.
It's like, why didn't we think of this before? I mean, it was one of those that was right in front of everybody, you know?
Brilliant. Yeah. Now, I love my Hammer horror. I know Rodney Barnes would love me to say that because I do. I love my Hammer horror films and my Hammer Dracula, and they are vicious Draculas. But then it becomes a storyline of, we got to save someone, and we got to do this, which is great, which is the basis of the vampire movie. There's always a beautiful girl to save, or an occult, or some way I've got to, you know,
the Victorian storyline.
But this one was just straight killing, and I was like, bring it. This was awesome. I love this movie. Let's move on quickly to 5. You know it. Everyone knows it. It is Friday the 13th. Yes, Friday the 13th. And the best thing I love about when I was making this trailer, like cutting it to make sure it goes straight through, this trailer is so epic in the fact that it just literally gave you 13 reasons why to watch this film. It's like, number one, here's a kill scene. Number two, body count. Number three, body count. And you were just like, it just keeps going and going and going. And you're like, I'm exhausted from this body count. This is awesome.
I love a movie that like it knows its strengths. Like, this is what we're doing.
Yeah, the best part about it, though, I always thought was like, man, you never got to see Jason. I mean, the mask and everything didn't come around until what, the third movie? Is that how it was?
I didn't get into these until I was already familiar with him in the hockey mask. Yeah. So unfortunately, I don't think I've ever been able to be objective enough where I like the first part, but it's in no way my favorite. I like 3, and I like, I think it's 8.
Jason goes to hell.
No, it's before they really started going crazy. Like, it was either 7 or 8, and he basically comes back up out of the river, and he just like trudges back on and kills people. And
Jason goes to New York.
He comes out of the lake.
Jason in space.
No, before that. There's too many Jason. See, then they got silly.
Freddy vs. Jason?
What'd you
Freddy vs. Jason. I actually like the Freddy vs. Jason. I thought that was fantastic.
It was weird.
I did too.
Did you like the remake of Friday the 13th?
I actually did.
I loved it.
I really, really liked it.
I loved it. It was good. Yes. There's Kevin Bacon.
Kevin Bacon.
We're all a one degree of Kevin Bacon over here in this house, so it's all good. It's all good. it was good. But again, those are the strengths of this, and this is what you call your
slasher film.
But it was your camp horror.
Yeah, Mama Knows Best.
Mama Knows Best. Yes,
because it was his mama that was doing the killing.
Yes, but let's face it, you're also promised a certain amount of nudity.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. 1980.
It was the beginning of the Skinamax.
Yes.
But in every Friday the 13th, somebody was going to be naked. And so you kind of got to satiate, like, all you're like, you know, as a young man watching these movies, just like, you know,
boobs.
Like boobs. Yes. And then it's just all
gore.
Scary and gore and all that stuff. And
Do you guys want to be alone?
For a minute.
Just for a minute.
That was the 80s, you know. That's what we want.
Yes.
Number 4 is Halloween, of course.
Absolutely.
You have that. It's so hard to put Halloween before Friday the 13th, Friday the 13th for Halloween. There's just so many people. But have you seen the new trailer that was supposed to come out this year? Man.
Oh, man. I love Halloween.
Halloween is so good.
Are you doing a new one? So what did you think of the last new one?
I thought it was fantastic.
This is great.
It was like classic slasher film done right. Like, people have been trying to do it, and John Carpenter, was it John Carpenter?
Yeah, John Carpenter.
He came back, and he's like, here's how you do it, boys. You know?
This is exactly how you do it. Don't take my stuff. And, of course, there was remakes of this one as well, which felt like, yes, Rob Zombie. Yes. So then there was, as you can see, I'm just like, yes, that's just, I like it.
This scene, like, that they keep showing clips, it's like, if all of the original Halloween is fantastic, it's easily, you get watched every year in my house.
Yes.
And it's what became like something I started incorporating in my work, because it really freaked me out, was once the once they're coming to go pick up Michael, it's dark. The only thing your headlights are picking up are the fact that there's patients just meandering around in the dark with their head down,
yes,
just walking.
Yes.
That alone scared the shit out of me, because I was just like, the idea that they're not there, they're there right in front of you, but not there. And it became something I was like, it was so brilliantly scary to me. I was like, I want to always do that kind of a thing. When I know I'm going to have somebody like that, I go back to the movie just for the vibe of it, just for this, because this discomfort, I hope, translates through into the work. But that weird scene where they pull up to pick him up and the, like, Michael has escaped, and then he smacks the car, and then he gets in and drives off. But
yeah.
But it just scares the living hell out of me. All those people just walking around out in the car.
Yeah, this is the part that got me the best. Because Lori was like, open the door. And there's the girls in there watching TV. And she's like, open the door. She's like, huh? Like, if someone was coming and you hear the music, you know, you hear like the big bass of that piano music. And she's just like, open the door. Like, that's a scenario that is a real scenario. If someone is really in trouble in real life and no one's opening the door, or they have their music on or their earbuds and they can't hear, that's a real life situation. And that, to me, scares me the most. You know what I mean?
Yeah, especially when, like, the person's got headphones on, they can't really hear, and then they think they hear something and they pull it out. And then they don't hear it, so they put it back in, and then the person goes back to be, and they just missed it.
Yes. Carpenter, Halloween 1 and 2, I don't think, like, there's very few that can beat the suspense of that. Like, those chase scenes through the hospital, Laurie Strode running, like, now, like, you spend those first two movies just on the edge of your seat the whole time.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
They got cool later, like in 4 and 5 and stuff like that. But
yes.
But I thought the last remake was kind of a little bit of a letdown.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, you heard it here first, guys. You heard it here first. Let's move on quickly to the next one, guys. And this one is a horror movie that a lot of people just can't get into. And I don't know why. Oh, why? Because you dream every night? Nightmare on Elm Street. Hello? Nightmare on Elm Street. I mean, people have insomnia. I used to have insomnia really bad. Skip the Sun, book one, is a dream like book. We won't give it away, but this is one of the most classic ones, and I put this above Friday the 13th and Halloween, is because this is what I consider your dream horror, because everybody dreams. Everyone's got something to dream about.
Anything can happen. That's the thing, though.
Anything can happen in your
dreams. Anything can happen.
Yes. And the fact that it had Johnny Depp, love him. The fact that those scenes where Freddy actually does run for you, where he's I was like, oh, he's going to get him? Freddy's going to get him. And I was like, get him, Freddy. You know, I was always rooting for Freddy when I was a kid. I think I was like maybe six when this came out. Yes. Everyone loved Freddy.
He quickly became the hero. Yeah.
Yeah.
I love this scene with Johnny Depp, because when he folds in, like, all the blood just goes up and everything. And it was the best. But this was the start of that, like, 80s final girl, where she's like, I'm gonna be like, daddy, there's something following me, dad. And then all of a sudden she's like, I'm gonna just handle it myself, hold on,
start fighting back.
Let's just hold on.
Everything with that, the marshmallows in the steps thing. That was insane. That was
insane. Number two, I know it's not for everyone, but number two for me is the human centipede first sequence. I'm sorry. This is your medical horror that just goes wrong. It's like, oh, look at me. I'm in a different country. Oh, no, I got sick. I need to see someone. I'm on the road. You're just tapping on someone's door. And then you wake up and this guy has these like sick fantasies of making you into a human centipede. You just happen to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. So have you seen this movie, Jason?
Yes.
He's like, yes.
I just so you know, I haven't seen it just because I know what happens and I really don't want to see it, to be perfectly honest. Okay. I don't want to see that.
This main actor, Dieter, I love him so much. Like he is like the Udo Kier of, you know, he has that face. He's always just looking like he's gonna kill you or do something to you. I love him so much. Like I wanna cast him in my next horror film just because he just looks like he would kill you, right?
Yep.
I mean, did you leave the theater when this came out? Because a lot of people left the theater when this came out. Sequence
oh,
one
I didn't
and sequence
watch
two.
This in the theater. Are you insane? No, I saw that at home. unfortunately. No, it's just on no level. On no level am I fond of this movie.
Like I said, I didn't even want to see it because I knew what happened. I was just like, oh my gosh, I do not want to see that.
Oh, but you have to.
Part of me, the young part, that, you know, it's just like, oh, it's gross and all this stuff. But like, I know, but like, I'd at least put Exorcist 3 up there or something else.
Right, exactly. And as you can see, everyone, this is where the bodies started to form and he actually makes them walk on all fours. And it is just happening. It's one of those. Let's quickly move on because we're almost done. I know, Jason's like, get away from that. This is my own horror film. Thank you very much, Verse Films Productions. Thank you. It's called The Dead of Night. This is what we call the resurrection film, where there is something left behind. It's basically unfinished business. And so we had premiered this in LA at the Landmark Theater over there. And we really enjoyed ourselves with that. Director of photography, John Orphan, shout out to you. Dennis Irakovich and Nana Makrishalavili. And then our original score, Black Light Odyssey, who worked with Depeche Mode. They did our score for us. And we were really excited to have an all-star cast as well as top-notch people in the industry. So go check it out at Verse Films Productions on YouTube. It is up, or it's on Vimeo, so go check it out. And we're excited, so that's my 1.5. But the number one scariest movie, or on my top 10 scary movies list, are you ready for it, Jason?
Yeah.
What do you think it would be?
After the human centipede, I'm completely thrown.
let's check it out. The number one is Hostel. Come on, Jason. It's Hostel. This is your foreign tourist horror movie where, again, you can do anything overseas, and this is the result of doing anything overseas. What did you think about this movie?
I had a good time. I really, really, really enjoyed the first one. I thought it hit all the creepy. It was uncomfortable. I wouldn't put it as number one by any stretch, but I thoroughly enjoyed it. I thought it was awesome. Like,
okay.
I'm not a huge fan of the torture stuff, but that first one was really, really, that was a scary movie.
It was a scary movie. And the fact that it was scary is because I like the trope where everything is coming along. Everything's smelling like roses. You got these guys who are sowing their oats. You know, they're like, oh, look at me. I'm going to be in over there. I'm going to be over there. And it just seems to be like a party fraternity type of beginning of the movie. And then it goes into a turn, and you're going, I've stayed in a hostel. I think not. I will be staying at 5-star hotels from now on. I will scrape up. I will do what I got to do, but I will not stay in a hostel. And this was the movie that made, I think, travel sales boost, because people want to be like, ooh, I want to go to Bratislava. I want to go to like these like remote Eastern, you know, these girls are like this, or guys are like this.
I don't want to be around them girls.
Well, are you serious?
In the beginning.
I mean, come on.
Beginning you did when they were in the spa. They're like, ooh, you want to go to spa? Yeah.
I mean, look at those guys. Those guys should have known better. They weren't good looking and all that. I mean,
they were not.
Come on.
They were not. But that concludes our top 10 remaster lists for the Skits team. So we thank you for playing, Jason. And we thank you for learning more about how you will not watch certain films in the theater. We appreciate that.
Yeah, I was the same with Hostel as well, man. Yeah. It's like,
you don't need
to
see some things that big.
No. I mean, to me, this is like verging on, like, those last two were verging on, like, Faces of Death. You know, it's like, I don't need to see that, you know?
You don't need to see that, but you will, and it's great. Guys, we're going to be wrapping this up shortly because we want to be cognizant of our guest time, and we thank him so very much. But before we go, we want to just show you some quick things for Skits. Let's see if we can get this just a little bit bigger for Skits. He did these drawings, and we want to make sure that we show these to you. This was, go ahead and narrate some of them real quick.
These were the Phantom Ghosts. I can't even remember the name now. The Phantom Shadows from Scooby-Doo.
Phantom Shadows from Scooby-Doo.
Yep.
And then we have, the other way. Oh, sorry.
You're at the bottom.
I was at the bottom. And then we just finished up this crow piece. We know that you are a fan of the crow. Jason as well, of course, Spawn, of course, but Michael did this, and this is...
Yeah, this is actually a takeoff of Kent Williams' Crow covers, so I wanted to kind of do something like that for Halloween, so I just felt like it came out really good, and I also wanted to use your style of inking. I got the splatters and stuff like that. I was trying to hone a little bit of you because I knew you were going to be on here. So that's kind of like a homage to you and to Kent Williams at the same time. So.
Exactly. And of course, everyone's seen this at Skits. This is actually in the book, or one of the concept pieces, but this scene
is in the book.
Yep.
This is page number 13 right here.
Page number 13. Skits is flying in the air from what we know not of. But this is the type of work that you are going to be getting with Skits the Sun Book 1. We just put up these pages not too long ago.
Yep. But we're actually going to be doing an update to the campaign. And we're going to be putting out, I think, the first 14 pages in black and white.
There you go. So guys, make sure that you check out Skits the Sun Book 1, and you will be able to see such great work by our creator and illustrator, Michael Siegenthaler. I am editor for the book and co-writer for the book, and this is some of the work that you are going to be getting and checking out with Skits the Sun Book 1, guys. So it is awesome. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you to our guest, Sean.
Wait. What? Did we want to say a little something? Why we have Jason on the show?
I mean,
not
right.
Just because we love him and he's a great artist and, you know, just a fantastic person, you know. What is it? Candy?
It's candy time.
No. I'm saying, don't we want to say?
Yeah, it's candy time. We're going to share some sweet candy news.
I know, but one little thing that we wanted to say here, also the reason why we're having him on the show, is Jason Sean Alexander is doing a cover for Skits the Sun Book 2. Book 2. I almost put up three fingers, but it's 2.
Yes.
And we can't be more thrilled to have him doing a little something for us.
We are really excited. So guys, Jason Sean Alexander is coming on board for Skits the Sun Book 2.
I can't wait.
This is right.
And I think he said his goal was to outdo Kent Williams. I think that's what he said.
What?
Isn't that what you said you had to do? Outdo Kent Williams?
I got to go back to work, guys.
You have his number. We have his number. So let's just find out what he says.
Well, I'll get really broad for a moment. Just like, truthfully, you kind of want to outdo everybody.
Exactly. It's true. Exactly.
It's true. Like, I want to see what everybody did on the first verse covers, and I want to just, I mean, because it pushes you as well. So, you know, yes. friendly competition. Like, I'm a fan, and I mean, I'm a huge influence on woodwork. I learned most of what I do in painting because of him. But it doesn't mean that he doesn't do beautiful covers that I still need to beat.
Exactly. You always got to whoop them. You always got to do as best you can and just, because that's the things that push us to do even better every time. There's people out there that I look at every day where I'm like, dang, why can't I do that? I need to do better.
You know? Exactly. So. And that's a positive thing. And we also had Patrick Reynolds for cover C. We love his work
I'm a huge fan. Patrick Reynolds, he's such a good guy.
Such a good guy. We've had him on the show twice now. Mm-hmm. We're really excited. He says hello, by the way, so shout out to you, Patrick Reynolds. We invited him on the show to be a surprise guest as well, to pop in. He's like, I'm actually doing work, so I can't.
He's got deadlines.
He's got deadlines. But yes, there you go, guys. That is one of our biggest surprises for the day. Jason Sean Alexander graciously will be on one of the variant covers for Skits the Sun book 2. So you do not want to miss getting the first book before you get the second book, because it was going to be phenomenal and we enjoy it. All right, Jason, we know you got to go. So do one last thing for me. Go ahead and throw your bows for me. Go ahead and throw your bows. Ready to come. Get some. That is right. We got Jason Sean Alexander to throw his bows on the show, and we love it. Guys, we love you guys. Take care. We're going to be showing Skits the Sun Book 1. Remember those contests. If you need to watch that replay, check out that replay and find out what giveaways we are giving away. There you go. There you go. Let's do it, guys. Skits the Sun Book 1. It's coming right at you. Thanks everyone for joining us. Skits the Sun Book 1. Go grab it. I am your host, Black Star. Black Star. I'm the host of the universe. Thank you everyone in the chat so much. We appreciate you. Go check it out. Bye.